one of the big physiology things that we saw, physiological changes we saw a change in maximal cardiac output. That's the only way I can explain that that VO2 max went up, right? And so the question becomes, well, how do you, how in these well-trained athletes, how do you get an increase in cardiac output? And to take one step back, you know, the reason why things like blood doping and other things work is because we're improving the oxygen delivery to the working muscle in endurance performance. That's really the only thing you can do that's really going to improve true performance very quickly. And that's why, like, all these athletes have focused on the red blood cells. Another way of doing that is to increase your cardiac output. And your max heart rate, your peak heart rate, that's not going to change. You really don't change that much at all. The only thing you can change is stroke volume. So the question becomes, how do you change stroke volume? We know that with when someone exercises, an untrained person starts training, one of the real big things happens, they're changing the blood flow back up to their heart. That creates a little more, that over time creates a little bigger left ventricular chamber. There's this it's a volume overloading, basically, which takes time. You get a little bigger chamber. That gives you, for every beat, you get a little bigger stroke volume. And so what we think is, because we had these people remain really well hydrated during their heat acclimation protocols, they were doing a lot of this heat training. We saw a pretty very, very good but not overwhelming increases in plasma volume, that they were training now with higher blood volume. And we think that caused some little bit increase in the stroke volume, and that resulted in increase in cardiac output. So all the groups that have kind of, no one's done the cardiac output as well as we can. I won't go into the technical details of how we do it, but it's a non-invasive way, it's the gold standard non-invasive way to look at cardiac output. There's other ways that are easier to go, but they're not as good.
And Chris, can I ask Dr. Minson, can I ask a quick question?
Chris is fine, yeah.
When you talk about improved cardiac function, I've seen studies where they attribute that to not a change in the volume of the left ventricle, but a change in the muscle thickness, so the greater pumping capacity. Typically take place over the other, or do they happen concurrently? How's that work?
They kind of happen concurrently, yes. And there's been some great work by a woman who doesn't do performance physiology, Mikhail Horowitz, has looked at some of the isoform changes in the muscle that happens with heat acclimation, and that may have some better contractility. What happens is, it's kind of the law of Laplace, and so if you have the wall tension is a function of the diameter of your chamber, and so if you start increasing the volume of that chamber, then the wall, in order to maintain wall tension appropriately, you have to have a thickening of the ventricle. So we know that as people endurance train, and it's debatable whether strength training does this or not, but with endurance trained athletes, you're almost always going to see a thickening of the left ventricle. So what that does is maintain the wall tension, so the left ventricle is getting overstressed during contraction. You can still have a full contraction, but it's also allowing you to have to maintain the full end diastolic volume is what you have at the end of filling of the heart, and systolic volume is the end of contraction. So if you have the ability to have that full contraction, but you've increased that end diastolic volume, now you've got a bigger stroke volume, difference between the two.
Okay.
Thanks. That wasn't the best explanation.
That's really good. That clarified a lot of things for me. Thank you.
Good. Sure. Yeah.
So basically what's happening, what you think, is that the heart is beating more blood for every beat. And yes, that is then increasing the aerobic or the oxygen in your system that you can then use to go faster.
Yes. In those athletes and under those testing conditions, yes.
Okay. So since we're on the topic of physiology, maybe you can clarify one more thing. So I understand that with heat acclimation, one of the big changes that enhances performance is that we get this increase in plasma volume. But as plasma volume increases, and that means we have more blood volume, and therefore the potential to have greater cardiac output, don't we still have the same number of red blood cells and the same amount, maybe not the same concentration, but the same amount of hemoglobin and therefore the same oxygen carrying capacity? So I don't understand how more watery blood would translate to greater oxygen delivery to the muscle. If this, right. It seems like that this, the amount of oxygen should be the same. Is that, what am I missing there?
No, so you're spot on, Chad. And that was the original concern we had working with Dathan Ritzenheim. When you look at it and you say, okay, we might create an increase in plasma volume and therefore have a reduction in the hematocrit, then that's really the percentage of red blood cells you have in your sample of blood. But that's also number of percent of red blood cells for any cardiac output. So take a high-level athlete, really high-level athlete, they might have a cardiac output of a very high value, to be 40, right? 40 liters per minute. And so that means that in 1 minute, at max cardiac output, they're going to have 40 liters of blood circulating, and I should use better, 40% of that would be red blood cells, approximately, right? So if you heat acclimate, that number might come down a little bit. And so your question is spot on. Would you have, now you're delivering less blood, red blood cells for that given cardiac output. So, but what we saw was an increase in cardiac output. So now if you say we got a slightly more dilute blood, if you will, but you have an increase to 43, 44 liters per minute, now you're delivering more red blood cells per minute basis.
Got it.
Right? And that's what it was going to be. So essentially every beat, you're getting a little more red blood cells, but we measure it per minute basis, and you're getting a few extra liters of circulating blood. So that's it's a difficult concept to try and to wrap your mind around, and we spent a lot of time trying to figure that out. But that's what we observed, and a few others have seen that as well.
Got it. Thank you for that.
That's awesome. I've always wondered that too. Cyclists and runners, we care a ton about weight, right? And we've talked about increasing plasma volume. And it was interesting about how much weight did these people gain in the intervention group?
Wow. So I don't actually remember the exact.
I know. It's 200 milliliters. So a little less than half a pound.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So I couldn't remember exactly. I was going to go back and say, well, how much was the plasma volume expansion? Was that weight change? And so, yeah, we care a ton about weight. But at the end of the day, that is not really going to be a huge performance benefit. I mean, you take any high level cyclist and you say, if I take a half pound away from you, would you prefer that? If I say, I'd like to make your bike a half pound lighter, would you like that performance increase? Then there's going to be this incremental improvement in performance. And, you know, Nate, I've heard you talk about how if you had done something different, you could win by 2 seconds more, you would have taken it, and you would have taken first versus second or something like that.
Yeah.
There's a lot that goes into actual performance on the line, of course, right? But when someone's doing an hour time trial, especially on a flat course, the weight's not going to make a difference. Even on hilly courses, a half pound versus having a higher cardiac output, I'll take the higher cardiac output any day.
Yeah, your results show it too with the lactic threshold improvements, the watt kg, totally worth the extra water weight in every single situation, even on this like a 10% climb. If you're Everesting, this would still be better for you than worrying about the plasma increase. If you like this video, make sure you give us a thumbs up.
If you didn't like this video, you can give it a thumbs down, but let us know what you would have done differently in the comments below.
If you want to see more of these videos, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you want to become a faster cyclist, check out trainerroad.com.
Do it.
If you think I have better hair than Jonathan, give it a thumbs up. If not, leave a comment.
My hair is better than his.